actually foreign language. And my title, I will share with you the presentation today. First, I will be talking a little bit about how I began my career as a diplomat, and then the language training in my foreign service organization, which is Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And I will then move on to what a diplomat does, and give you four different case studies. And that, as a conclusion, I will give some thoughts on the diplomatic expressions, especially what kind of aspects you have to bear in mind in using those expressions. So first, in 1979, I was a freshman in my university, and that was the year when Soviet Union deployed the SS-20. I don't know how many of you know about SS-20. It's an intermediate range nuclear missiles, and it was deployed in Europe as well as in the Far East. So also in Japan, there were a very strong reaction amongst the public as well. I saw a lot of local municipalities announce, declare as their city territories as a nuclear free zone. So I was, I would say, not naive, but maybe idealistic student of international relations. I was impacted by those movements. So I thought I can do something personally as well. So I decided to take a diplomatic exam in Tokyo after 4 years. That was 1984 when I graduated. So I joined the Foreign Service in that year. And until now, if you're a newcomer, you have to choose one language of specialization. It could be English, French, German, Russian, Chinese, Arabic, and so on. But because of my interest in this heightened tension during the Cold War years, I naturally hoped for Russian language, and they accepted that offer. So once you join, you have to go through 4 months intensive language training at Foreign Services Language Institute. This is the old building, which we sold already to a university, but still is there in downtown Tokyo. That was when I started Russian. I never had any Russian language experience when I was a student, so I started with alphabet. Then the next year in 1985, I moved to, as Motoko-san introduced me, to Middlebury Summer School. It was 9-week language course, as I said. And when I finished, of course, with my American classmate, we changed to English. And he teased me, I still remember, that was 35 years ago, but he teased me by saying that my English has Russian accent. And well, he was teasing me, but I thought maybe it's a compliment. After 9 weeks, I didn't speak any English. Then, as Motoko-san said, I moved to Defense Language Institute in Monterey, California. Total immersion, not just in Russian language, but also military environment. Then I had 1 year of area studies at Columbia University in New York City, and then moved to Moscow. Moscow State University's language course for foreigners. But I, of course, there were a lot of memories, but my Russian friend came to me, to my apartment once. And so I saw them, I showed them a dictionary. Actually, that was a Russian-English dictionary of vulgar expressions and slangs. And that was a banned book in the Soviet Union. I bought that in Monterey, brought it from United States. And I remember they couldn't stop laughing, looking at those expressions. They all knew the expressions, but nothing was in print. And I still remember some of them, they told me that some of them were wrong grammatically. So that was my language training experience. So let me move on to what does a diplomat do? Of course, diplomats do a lot of functions, different roles. First one may be the most important two priorities are reporting the situation of the host country. That's first one. We normally do it through reading or listening to open sources like newspapers. You see Japanese major newspapers here, or interview experts. So you have to have a reading skill as well as listening and interviewing skills. And then the second, maybe most important function is to communicate your government's view, Tokyo's view to your host nation. In my case right now is Canada. And if there's any difference, you have to negotiate a solution. Nowadays, we have to do it through, oftentimes through video conferencing, like in this picture. And then another important function is to arrange high-level visits and meetings. This is Prime Minister Abe meeting with Prime Minister Trudeau last year in Ottawa when I was involved in the preparation. The 90 means that we are celebrating 90-year anniversary of diplomatic relationship. And this is a rugby jersey. So we hosted the last year Rugby World Cup. That's why they are holding it. But diplomats really have to prepare good substance for such a meeting, because high-level political leaders meetings are very important in order to advance bilateral cooperation, as well as if it's a difficult relations, it often produces a breakthrough. Some other functions or roles we do is to promote the interest of business. For example, we promote the business, Japanese business. If you're in Canada, I do a lot of requests to Canadian federal government to improve the conditions or regulations subject to Canadian or Japanese business. But not only that, we also do a lot of promotions directly of our products. So this photograph shows a sake promotion event held by our embassy. Another very important role we do is protect your citizens, our citizens abroad. So it's not just that we call this the consular affairs, but it's not just issuing visas or passports, but also it involves sometimes evacuation of the citizens. And this is a picture of a drill or exercise held in Thailand last year, actually using the our self-defense forces airplane. And these Japanese people who volunteered to participate in the drill. So this is in a kind of extreme case when your host nation is in turmoil and there's no other means to protect your citizens other than to evacuate them. And actually under current COVID-19 pandemic, we had to organize, maybe not in this huge scale, but in a smaller scale using commercial airplanes to evacuate our citizens from some of the developing nations. So we talk about developing nations. We do a lot of developing assistance. And we do, for example, food assistance, training of specialists, like in this picture, providing infrastructure, and so forth. But under COVID-19 epidemic, we do a lot in the sphere of public health. And lastly, public diplomacy and cultural exchange. This is to approach the general public in your host nations in order to create or improve the image of your own country. So if you're in Canada, you try a lot of cultural events or giving interviews to media in order to create a favorable image of Japan. So those are the main roles that a diplomat do in a foreign country. Now I'll give you four case studies, which based on my experience, I talked about the importance of preparation of political leaders' meetings. First one was in 1991 when Gorbachev, when he was a Soviet Union's president, visited Japan for the first time. That was the first Soviet leader's visit to Japan. And met with Prime Minister Kaifu, who are here in the picture. Gorbachev is on the left and the Prime Minister is on the right. And the negotiation wasn't very easy over the disputed island. It's called Northern Territories. It's four islands off the coast of Hokkaido, and which we claim. And as a result of the negotiations, they signed a statement, which for the first time Soviet Union recognized the existence of the issue and the importance of resolving the issue through a conclusion of peace treaty. So this picture, if you look at it very carefully, they're doing a pinky promise using your pinky finger. This is maybe Americans do it when you're small, but in Japan, sometimes jokingly, even adults do it. So Prime Minister Kaifu offered Gorbachev to do a pinky promise for Gorbachev to implement the clause in the statement over the territories. I was involved mostly logistically, not necessarily in negotiations at all. I was a very young officer at that time. Then after 6 years, 1997, in Russian Siberia, a city called Krasnoyarsk, Prime Minister Hashimoto at that time visited the city for informal talks with President Yeltsin, who was president of Russian Federation at that time. And I was already involved in the substance of the meeting. This was intended to be a very informal meeting. This was not in Moscow or in Tokyo. They had to talk on Northern Territories while they're fishing in Enisei River, which flows in Krasnoyarsk. And as a conclusion, and this was the picture from press stakeout after the meetings, they announced that the peace treaty, which of course implies that the resolution of the territorial issue should be signed by year 2000. I'm not in this picture, but I'm behind the crowd. So I was part of the Japanese delegation. And the man who is on the right-hand side from Prime Minister, who wear kind of sky blue jacket, would be my future boss. He was a vice minister for foreign affairs, who was a delegation from the civil servants, delegation head, and supporting the prime minister. But he would become ambassador to Russia when I moved from Tokyo to Russia several years later. So second example, I talked about meetings at high level. They were all bilateral meetings, but now I'm going to multilateral meetings and the importance of reaching consensus through negotiations involving many participants. We hosted a conference involving the conflict of Western Balkans. Western Balkans are the states of former Yugoslavia. And after the demise of former Yugoslavia, they separated and there was a war in Kosovo, ethnic unrest in Kosovo and war in Bosnia. And when we organized this conference, it was in 2004. The peace was not so consolidated yet. It was very fragile. The unrest in Kosovo was still going on. And Japan was advocating not just peace itself, but the importance of the post-conflict regulations of the process, especially peace building and peace consolidation. So in this region where European Union is very active, of course it's part of Europe, and they are primarily concerned about the situation. And here, former Yugoslav states like Serbia, Bosnia, and other countries involved are the main actors. So EU have been, European Union has been negotiating very hard to keep the peace intact. But here's Japan, and Japan and EU have been a very strong partner, strategic partner that share common values like democracy, human rights, and rule of law and things like that. So as a part of a strategic partnership cooperation between Japan and EU, as a director of Central Europe and Southeastern European regions, I decided to host this Western Balkan Peace Consolidation Conference with the consent of, I got approval of my bosses, including my foreign minister, who made a keynote speech at this conference in the photograph you see at the left-hand side above corner. But in the course of preparations, you had to negotiate not just with the EU, but also, of course, with former Yugoslav states. And they are fighting each other until recently. So it was not easy. So we had to use kind of EU and Japan peer pressure to bring them about with a positive note on commitment to peace and commitment to make progress in economic reform and so forth. So I wanted to kind of encourage those states by announcing some measures in the field of economic assistance, like police training or some other development assistance for small and medium-sized business in those states. So for those announcements, I needed to coordinate with, for example, a police agency in Japan. So I went through their office and negotiated. So this was not just a two-sided EU-Japan, EU-former Yugoslav negotiations, but it involved domestic internal Japanese procedures. And one of my staff, in addition to these two measures, suggested that sport could be used for demonstrating the importance of reconciliation among these former Yugoslav states. So we invited Serbian professional football player who was at, by that time was a head coach of Japanese Nagoya Grampus. It's a football team in Nagoya City, a major city in Japan, to make a speech during this conference, during the lunchtime, about the importance of reconciliation through sport. And after we finished the conference, actually the conference went relatively smoothly. All the negotiations were very went very well. And former Yugoslav foreign ministers who came on our invitation were very forthcoming in the reform efforts, peace commitment. So after that, we brought all the ministers to play soccer with Japanese politicians. So this is the scene from the this sport event. I think Mr. Stojkovic is on the left-hand side. One of our vice ministers here, who is a politician, is on the left-hand side. But Yugoslav side or former Yugoslav side, they wore a national costume of Yugoslavia to demonstrate their unity. Of course, they are separate already, but in sport, virtually they were able to fight in one team against the Japanese. And guess who won? Of course, the former Yugoslav ministers won. We were very weak. And after that, next day, Mr. Stojkovic brought the ball, who was signed by the ministers of former Yugoslav states, to Prime Minister Koizumi. And he also signed the ball. So the ball is still preserved in our headquarters office in Tokyo. Now, case study three, I'll talk about public diplomacy. I was in Russia for the third time, and I was leading the public diplomacy section of our embassy. Russians had a very good image about Japan, despite of this disputed territorial issue. They saw and still see in Japan as a advanced, technologically advanced state, as well as a country which values the tradition. So we did lots of cultural events like this one, Russian girls practicing calligraphy. Of course, if you study Japanese, you can read what they're trying to write. So we did a lot of these traditional events as well as pop cultural events. And on the media front, which is kind of a policy advocacy front, I often gave interview to radio, local radio, or television. In terms of radio stations, I often was invited to radio stations called Radio Echo Moskvy, the Echo of Moscow. And I was even given blog space for anything that I can write about. I had that freedom in their website. So this is a scene from the interview I gave at the studio. And because of this connection with this radio, I was able to have my foreign minister give interview at their studio where I'm sitting a little bit later at the end of this year, 2011, or maybe it was 2012. So I was very active in leading the public diplomacy team at their embassy. Now, the last example, I was posted to an island called Sakhalin in 2015. It was 7 years after the end of the war. We had a small consulate in Yuzhno-Sakhalinsk, which is the capital of the province. And I was working there. It's just 1.5 hours flight from Hokkaido. It's just next to us. And half of this island was part of Japan until 1945. So there are a lot of old buildings built by Japanese during those years. It was Japanese territory from 1905 to 1945, for 40 years. And there were about 400,000 Japanese living there. And there are still 100 or so Japanese first generations, as well as second, third, fourth generations are living. And we drove from Yuzhno-Sakhalinsk to upper north, where there were the boundaries. So this yellow X shows where the boundary was. It's a 50-degree parallel, and there are a lot of ruins, but this one is a kind of a we call it a pillbox, a type of a forest of Japanese Imperial Army. You see the window used to shoot the enemies. And in August 9th of 1945, just 6 days before the end of the war, the Soviet Union invaded Japan, violating the treaty of neutrality between the Soviet Union and Japan. And there were a fierce battle near this fort. And then after the battle, they went southwards to Yuzhno-Sakhalinsk, and they occupied the southern half. And then they moved, they advanced to, actually said to be a plan to occupy northern part of Hokkaido, but the Americans opposed to it. So they changed the course and occupied the four islands, which are Etorofu, Kunashiri, Shikotan, and Habumai. Now we call Northern Territories. So that's the beginning of this long-standing issue. And in the summer of 2015, when I was there, Russians were planning to hold a military parade all over Russia, including in Yuzhno-Sakhalinsk, in the beginning of September, to commemorate the 70 years anniversary of the end of the war. But it was obvious that the event will going to be to glorify the victory of the Soviet troops, which was, I think, accepted as a kind of bitter thing for the Japanese because of this territorial issue and invasion by the Soviet troops. We think that the true reconciliation between Russia and Japan could be achieved maybe only through these resolution of this territorial issue, the four islands issue that we claim. And we thought at this time, at that time in 2015, that we should do something in parallel with this, the Russian parade that may draw attention of the local people to the importance of reconciliation and the importance of praying for the peace and remembering of those people who died during this combat. So there's a memorial, actually. The Russians are allowed to construct one. It was erected by a Japanese government near this yellow X, near this fort. So we went there. I took a small group of Japanese and Russians as well to this memorial, which is in this picture. That's me laying the flowers and praying for the peace as well as the the reconciliation as well as the deaths who demised during the war. And it was important also for me to see also some of the Russians who accompanied my group, who also gave a speech about the same feeling also from the Russian side. He is a former Sakhalin region vice governor. He's retired, but he was kind enough to come with us. And there were Russian local journalists who took these pictures, and they uploaded those pictures for the people in Sakhalin to look at it and what was prayed for during the event and so forth. So that was a small event, but that was on my initiative and a small attempt to somehow mitigate that bitter feeling we had during those months and years. So those are the four cases. And as a conclusion, I would like to give you some of my thoughts on diplomacy and language, something that I learned in my career. There are a lot of things, but I'll just give you four examples. First, you often have to persuade the other side, starting from the big things like islands, you have to negotiate with the Russians, but also daily, almost every day when you communicate with, let's say I'm in Ottawa right now, so with the Canadian Foreign Ministry or Foreign Department, they call Global Affairs Canada, colleagues, we have to request something, we have to seek their support, we have to seek their understanding, at least maybe tacit understanding. They are classified as attempts to persuade your counterparts. So that's a kind of a basic range from the very simple ones to the most difficult ones politically. But the important thing that you have to have in mind is to seek or to offer something also beneficial to your counterpart. At least you have to find some kind of overlapping interest between you and if you're in Ottawa, Canadians, so that you can at least mitigate the difference, close the gap in order to reach agreement. So that's persuasion. Another thing is understanding of what the other side is saying. It's not easy, actually. It's not always straightforward because the other side may not tell you, they want to tell you some nice things. So if they're denying what you requested, they won't say, I don't like it, or I deny, I don't support you. That's too straightforward. So they say very in an indirect manner. So you have to understand the nuances. So that requires certain language skill, maybe psychological skill in order to understand what's the real feeling behind the words. Or in opposite case, if you make compromise, you don't say I'm compromising or I can make compromise. I can agree with you. They say something totally opposite, but in reality, they are making a compromise. They do this because we do as well, Japanese or maybe Americans or Canadians. They do this because you don't want to lose your face. It's face losing is kind of an embarrassing thing. So you want to look nice also themselves, yourselves. So you say, you tend to sound like you're not agreeing at all, but in reality, in essence, you're agreeing to your counterpart. So you have to understand the true feeling. That's requires some very, maybe not some, but very deep skill or skill of understanding the other side. Let's go to some negative things. We have to protest against what the other side is doing. You have to express you know, your uncomfortableness. There are a lot of different expressions, like we are concerned, or you can say it's regrettable that you did this, or if you do it, we will regret that. You can also say, you can say straightforwardly, we protest against you, or we denounce what you have done, things like that. So there are degree of strengths of your feelings. So you have to use that, because sometimes when we are, or maybe oftentimes when we are in conflict oftentimes escalate. Oftentimes, of course, on other occasions de-escalate. So you have to have a kind of a ladder of escalation and expression in accordance with the latter, so that you can gradually level up your degree and the strengths of your protest feelings. Now, lastly, I talked about multilateral conference and the importance of building consensus. So anywhere like United Nations or any other organization, what we participate in, we have to build consensus if there are more than the party of two. And there are, the goals that you want to achieve if you're leading the consensus building procedure. But there are different parties involved, and they have different interests, different views, different positions. You have to have only one consensus. Consensus is one. So oftentimes the game will end up in finding acceptable expression, so language expression. So you have to find a good expression that satisfies all. So here you need a very fine-tuned language skill in English or whatever language is used officially in the negotiations. There's a dilemma for the leaders who are leading the consensus building process. But because as you go farther towards a more acceptable expression for everybody you will lose the focus, and you will end up in something too compromising, not the high enough aim that you aimed at in the beginning of the negotiations. So I think there's a trade-off between a strong consensus and the ambition that you set in the outset. That's a dilemma that you always face if you are negotiating in a multilateral conference. So it depends on the level of common interest shared by the participants, I have to say, because it's a like-minded countries, for example, G7, of course, G7 countries also disagree on some of the issues, but they're mostly like-minded, or all of them are like-minded and share the common values very well. So it's relatively easy compared to other kind of forum. But even there, you have to find good, strong content in order to make progress in the things that you want to achieve. So these are the four examples, and I would like to end here and like to say as a conclusion, language matters almost always, or always actually. I tend to wanted to say almost, because sometimes and maybe many times human relations with your counterparts matters as well, because even if you disagree with your counterpart, if you have a good relations with him or her, then you can kind of solicit, you can ask that your counterpart to disclose what's the real reason behind their denial or the difficulty they're facing in trying to agree with you or not trying to agree with you. And then that background information or the true feeling may help. If you convey that to your headquarters, it will help them understand better about the difficulty your counterpart is facing, and that sometimes help for example, our Tokyo people to find a better solution. Maybe we can make a compromise where we can and allow the counterpart to retain that part that is very difficult for them to make compromise. So this is kind of a give and take calculation, but this kind of human relationship may be able to smooth out this kind of deal. And so thank you so much. And actually, this 35-year period of being a diplomat was quite exciting experience, was quite exciting for me. And you, of course, serve your country. You meet distinguished people, starting from the president and, your counterpart diplomats. And also through studying the foreign language, you understand the culture and the history of the country. I remember when I was, I said about 1991, Gorbachev's visit to Tokyo, and I was just a behind the scene man. But there was one occasion when I was able to talk to Mr. Gorbachev. And because I was asked to do a translator for Japanese Parliament's speaker. His name was Sakurauchi. Sakura is cherry blossoms. And it was April 1991 when the cherry blossom was in full bloom. And we were waiting. I was supposed to do a translation for interpretation for Mr. Sakurauchi. We were waiting in front of a building where the concert, the classical music concert, was organized for Mr. and Mrs. Gorbachev. So I was very nervous standing in the waiting line, but here he came. And guess what Mr. Sakurauchi said to Mr. Gorbachev? He was pointing to himself and said, "Sakura, Sakura," because that was part of his name. And they met before, so he thought that Gorbachev remembers if he points out to himself and say, "Sakura, Sakura." He was is a man with humor. And I had to translate that into Russian language. Вот это вишня. That was, this is cherry blossoms. That's in Russian. But of course, Gorbachev knew this Japanese word sakura very well. So he said, "Oh, sakura, sakura," in Japanese. And he went away to got into the concert hall. There was no need for translation at all. So that was just a kind of an end note, very memorable for me experience. But that was, so you met with Gorbachev. You can say, "I met Gorbachev." So that was the good part of experience as a diplomat. Thank you so much for your attention, and very much welcome your questions.
ありがとうございます。では、今村講師、can you and share.
Share what?
And share the screen.
Uh-huh.
Hi. Hi. ありがとうございました。あの、歴史あり、地理あり、なんか面白いあのお話をたくさん聞けて、大変参考に勉強になりました。Thank you very much. As Imamura Koshi said, if you have any comments or questions, I would like to open the floor. And you can raise hands by pressing the blue raise hand icon, and I will just go through the participants list. So if you have a question or comments, please raise your hand. And this is what I usually do, but I have a icebreaker question, very general question to you, Minister Imamura. So what advice do you have to language school students? It's a vast question.
Well, if you want to be very fluent in your language, I think schooling is just a very small part of everything. So it's you have to study lifelong, as I'm doing. I'm still studying Russian language. And as Tabuza-sensei introduced me in the outset, I enjoyed translating the book. That was just extra. That was not part of my profession. And I used days off in order to translate the book. It took 10 years. I found the book in 2008 when I was in Moscow and at a bookstore. And I translated, but because of my busy schedule, it took about 10 years to publish it. But if you have that kind of a, long-term project, even after you finish Middlebury or any school, studying Russian or Japanese, and then you embark on not necessarily something related to the language, but I really recommend you to not to lose the investment you have done, but continue in a way that you like I did, and that will be a rewarding experience, I'm very much sure.
Right, thank you very much. Now, I have a hand from Noashiru-san, dozo.
Noashiru-san, thank you very much. It was a very enlightening presentation. I guess my question for you is, as citizens of a said country, if we're visiting a foreign country, what would you suggest? You mentioned some of your lessons were helping to build consensus and helping to kind of develop general public diplomacy and cultural image. I mean, obviously learning language is part of that. I guess what part could we have individually in positively portraying our own nationality or our own culture to the said country?
Of course, if you study one foreign language, you might want to visit that country. So you can volunteer in one way or another through participating and, engaging the citizens locally. You might start from, just personal relationship. Then if you are there in a foreign country studying, then you might want to suggest to do some kind of a small event. Are you an American?
I'm an American citizen, yes. I didn't grow up in the US, but I'm
American. And you're studying, yes. And you're studying Japanese?
I am, yes, it's a minor.
I see. So if you go to Japan, maybe you make Japanese friends and you might suggest them to do a culture event related to United States or maybe from your own state where you're from. And you can start from there. Just if you're a student, if you're in an organization like university there, they might want to come close to you. Maybe that college or university has a international day or international cultural event day, and they might suggest you to organize kind of a co-hosting event for American culture or something like that. That's one way. Or if you're bold enough to give interview to a media, nowadays media is all media. I mean, starting from social media to major media, there are a lot of opportunities. So you might want to approach them, like maybe starting from social media and talk about yourself.
Fantastic.
Yeah, but use Japanese.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you very much for that. Yeah. I think that's good advice, especially to me, I guess, to be a little more outgoing. I think that will help me not only with like cultural relations, but also with my language skills. Mm. So thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you for your question.
ありがとうございます。その次はリードさん。Or other people who can't find the blue raise hands button, just send me a chat privately, and then I will call in you. Okay? So リードさん、どうぞ。
ありがとうございます。My name is Caroline Reed, and I'm a graduate student at George Washington University, and I'm actually studying conflict resolution. So thank you very much for coming here, and Kocho-sensei, thank you very much for having him. I can tell that you have had a lot of experiences in very profound events, and I was wondering if you ever, at any time in your career, felt overwhelmed, or that you felt like one small person can't make a difference, and if that has ever happened to you, what did you do about it?
Okay. That's a very good question. Of course, you know, Foreign Service in any country is a big organization. So currently we have about 7,000 people, and so if you are responsible for a certain area like Western Balkans, which I explained, you of course want to do, let's say, a conference. So you have to push through with your ideas. So you have to do a lot of internal work before you go to other countries. And so sometimes that's difficult, but if things are like that, if you initiate your ideas on yourself, that's still most likely you might have to change your course a little bit, but mostly you can be successful. But you said about overwhelming case, that's something that come from outside, for example, like a huge disaster or accident or some kind of a diplomatic role that may disrupt the ordinary process. So, you know, current COVID-19 pandemic is maybe personally very overwhelming, as well as for the political leaders, for all of us. So this is maybe one example, a pandemic that is not necessarily easily controlled. So we're putting lots of efforts and resources in order to mitigate. So maybe that's a good example. But there are, you know, worrying tendencies that used to be there even before the pandemic, and that's accelerating. But also at the same time, there are goodwills, a lot of goodwills amongst nations to cooperate. For example, we cooperate a lot in vaccine development right now, which is a very good thing. So maybe for one person, it's very overwhelming, but if we try to organize and cooperate, bring in other partners, then we can achieve a lot more. Yeah, thank you.
ありがとうございました。
はい、ありがとうございます。We have Chinchilla san, Veronica san, どうぞ。
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Minister Imamura. In the fall, this coming fall, I'll be attending MIS in Monterey. And the question that I have is about how important is the knowledge of history of the country that you're working in terms of building consensus or in working with your fellow kind of officers?
Mm-hmm. It's very important, especially the current history, you know, the history of maybe last 10 or 20 years. Because that's very relevant to the pattern of thinking of the current leaders or people in that country. And it will give you a better understanding how the local people think about themselves and even outside world. I said 10 to 20 years, but also sometimes 50, 60, 70 years, because I talked about the 70-year anniversary after the war. Second World War also still continues to, you know, impact the people's you know, minds. So history really matters.
Thank you.
はい、ありがとうございます。その次はショウォルターさん、ショウォルティアさん、どうぞ。
Thank you. What I was wondering is, do you have any other life experiences where you may be discussing something that's very tense or something that's very difficult between the parties, where the conversation kind of ends up in a more casual, very friendly sort of outcome instead of being formal the entire time?
You mean a conversation with foreign counterparts that what entails kind of friendly substance or?
More so like, sort of like the Sakura story where you expect it to be a much more, I guess, formal, tense, you're discussing something very serious, but instead because of the relationship or perhaps you've developed a relationship over many months or many years, you're much closer to the party and you can speak at a much more casual level, or is it always formal?
Oh, no, actually, in most cases, it's more casual and more friendly. I talked about cultural events. They are mostly very friendly. I mean, we organize something entertaining to the local people. So, of course, we cannot do it alone. So we need to negotiate with the local film theaters, for example, or local cultural organizations or local universities. So there are some kind of not tense, but elements of negotiations, but almost without any exception, I think all those talks were very friendly. They were quite welcoming with the Japanese cultural events to be organized in their premise. So I enjoyed those very much. Still have a good memory. One example, maybe you need examples. I talked about calligraphy, but we did also lots of Japanese pop culture events, which I saw some of you who asked today questions had a poster of filmmaker Miyazaki's films. But we did a lot of anime showing as well as cosplay shows. So I never thought of doing cosplay show organizing. We were organizers. So we were recruiting Russian girls, and we brought a Japanese costume, cosplay costume, and they liked it, and they appeared on the stage doing a lot of shows. So I mean, cosplay shows. So I never thought of doing it as a foreign service officer, but we did it, and that was just fun. So. So I hope that will give you some good image of what we did.
Of course, thank you.
Yeah.
Hi. Any other questions from students, participants? No? Is there anything that...
Sumimasen.
Hi, Sumimasen. Dozo.
Hi. Imamura-san, thank you so much for your wonderful talk. I just had a question. You mentioned kind of you in the 70s and early 80s kind of working kind of behind the scenes to negotiate peace between Japan and the USSR. I'm just curious, going forward, do you see trends in international relations as being kind of more, it's more important to have these people behind the scenes, and these people are very, very central to the peace process globally? Or do you see that foreign service and foreign relations kind of moving away from these foreign service diplomats behind the scenes working and becoming more, it's the large powers in a given country, either the president or congressional bodies that are leading foreign service or foreign relations? Thank you.
Yes, thank you for the question. I think the role of the diplomats are enhancing, it's becoming more relevant against the background of actually not necessarily looking so. I mean, the players definitely increased. So it's not just politicians, political leaders and professional diplomats and congressional leaders, but also non-governmental organizations, international organizations. We see a lot of, media, different types of media, and even cyber attack that may impact you. So there are a lot of different kinds of actors, non-state actors especially, including terrorists and, those, pirates and those guys who are bad guys. Because of this complexity, I think the need for coordination and diplomacy in order to achieve stability and prosperity in the world is more felt than before. Of course, it was always important, but because of the relative simplicity of the world, the role of coordination was not so complicated, maybe 50 years ago. Although we had a major war 70, 80 years ago. But now, because of this complex situation and also changing technology, I mentioned about the intervention through cyber attack, and also the difference in speed of economic development led to a change in power balance. There were countries that arose quite rapidly in the past 10, 15 years. And because of these complexities, I think the role of the diplomacy is more important than ever. And our role is becoming more relevant and important. The only thing is that we alone can solve almost anything. We have to involve other sectors or other parties in order to achieve. So that's the difference and the difficulty.
Wonderful, thank you so much.
Hi, arigatou gozaimasu. Guess what? When you're having fun, time flies. It's 2:02 now. So thank you again, Minister Imamura. Please, let's give him a big round of applause.
Thank you very much.
Well, the next time, please come to the Millbury campus and then maybe organize a cosplay event.
Yeah.
Question mark?
Yeah. If you want to wear cosplay costume, yes.
I think we will be ready. Anyway, so this concludes today's alumni event. Thank you very much again, and please stay safe. Sayonara.
ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。